an absolutely gorgeous day. A little bit chilly, you know, for being spring, but still it's God's day, so we can warm up each other. We're so happy to have you here today. I have dear, dear friends, and we have a baptism that we're going to have today of grandchildren. And I say grandchildren because the parents, I met them when they were very young. So Ida, what that makes us? Don't say it. We're just becoming a little bit wiser, correct? Yes. But welcome, welcome. It's so good to have you here today and feel at home. And if anybody else that is coming to visit today, we are, again, a church with open arms, open hearts, lots of imagination, and always asking to be connected some way, somehow. George is going to tell us, how can we be connected?
That's the question of the morning, and I have some help this morning. First of all, you'll notice on your weekly flame there are a number of new articles, new things that are happening where Hope Church can be connected. But the thing I want to share is Tuesday night is Hope's Place. And we have a great topic, Lyme disease. We have two of our elected state officials, Senator Gobi and Representative Petrolatti will be here also. And so I invite you to come and join the group. But it won't happen if we don't have some people in the kitchen and some servers. And so at this point, there was nobody signed up, so I would appreciate that if you could help in any way on Tuesday to see Kathy Gibson right here after church or downstairs at fellowship time. Don Kresge.
Good morning. I just would like to mention to you this coming Saturday, May 2nd, there's a small group going to Kate's Kitchen in Hoyle and to serve lunch to the homeless and families in need. If anyone is interested, please see me or Jack or Ingmar after the service today. And we meet at the church next Saturday at 11 o'clock and we can carpool, okay? And we serve from 12 to 1. And it's very, very rewarding. Thank you.
John, thank you. Now I'd like to call up Alice Collins.
Good morning. I just wanted to share some things with you this morning about Imagine No Malaria. There was a very exciting press release that came out this week from the United Methodist Church. And I'm just going to read just a little bit of it to you. It says, the people of the United Methodist Church today, today was Thursday, I believe, will make a historic donation to the Global Fund with a gift of $9.6 million, the single largest contribution made by a faith organization to the Geneva-based institution. United Methodists throughout the world contributed to the Imagine No Malaria initiative through donations and grassroots fundraising efforts ranging from pancake breakfasts to 5K runs to lemonade stands. So this is really exciting because guess what, folks? That grassroots effort, that's us. We're part of that. And we've had pancake breakfasts. We haven't had a 5K run, but we've had lemonade stands and bake sales, and we had somebody who was willing to have their head shaved. And it's through efforts like ours that this happened. I think you should all give yourselves a round of applause. The bishop, Thomas Bickerton, who leads the church's Imagine No Malaria campaign. He says, today we celebrate with our partner, the Global Fund, the work we are doing to end preventable deaths from malaria on the continent of Africa Our work is making a difference. And it hasn't ended yet. I believe that they've reached... ...88% of the goal that they set to for the money that they wanted to raise by the end of the year 2015. The Sunday school, last year, we set a lofty goal of $2,000, and thanks to George, in part, we did make our goal. This year, we said that we would try again to raise $2,000. At this point, I think we're about $1,100. So, I think the, yes, we celebrate that. I think that's, I actually, when I added it up, I was surprised that we had done that well. I think it's been a, we've kind of lost a little of the oomph with the fundraising. So now we need to put a push on before the end of the Sunday school year to try to at least come where near that. And there's one thing that might help a little bit. The other thing that I read this week is that the United Methodist Foundation has a matching challenge. For every dollar the churches raise this spring, April, May, and June, they will match the funds. So that gets me thinking in my head, okay, we only need to raise another $450, because that times two is 900. I don't think that's cheating, do you? Oh, no. So, the Sunday school for this month, on the day of the plant and craft sale, we will be having another one of our lemonade and bake sales. If anybody would like to help us out and donate some baked goods to sell, that would be wonderful. And you can come and buy some baked goods when you come to get your plants.
Alice, because I know that's one of the projects that you save lives. It's a project that, thank you, Gretchen, that do save lives. I want just to say, I want to save 10 lives. So if anybody would like to join me, and that's so for a goal, you have another $100.
All right.
So anybody who would like to save one life, five lives, or 10 lives, please just talk to Alice, and you know, maybe okay. We will go over the goal.
Okay, so that brings me to another project. Now we have, okay, we're down to $350 that we have to raise. the other thing we're going to do that the Imagine No Malaria has had a slogan recently, bring change, or for those of you who are under 30, hashtag bring change. So we've come up with a slogan for our church. We are going to bring change to bring change. So I want you to bring your change, the copper and silver kind. Got a good start here. Bring your change from home. There will be a jar like this at the back of the sanctuary over the next month. There'll be another one down in Fellowship Hall. And we have these lovely red boxes. I'll make sure there's one of these in each of the Sunday school rooms, Collis room. So you can empty your pockets at any time that you feel moved to do so. So I'm hoping with a little prayer and a few other generous people that we will make our goal this year. Thank you.
Amen.
Thanks, Alice. Time to prepare ourselves for worship. Time to feel the quietness. Time to prepare ourselves to feel the Holy Spirit's presence as we worship as a Christian community and family.
Thank you.
Please rise if you're able and join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. What a joy it is to welcome you this day. Christ, the Good Shepherd, invites you to walk with him.
We accept that invitation, confident in his guidance.
Be ready to serve the Lord in all that you do, for his love has been poured upon you.
Open our hearts and spirits this day. Give us the faith which can remove mountains. We want to receive your holy words and to be challenged in our service to you.
Amen. Let's join in singing our first hymn, number 650, found in your red hymnal. Be seated. Let us pray. Life-giving God, you put out the welcome mat for us as we gather to worship you. You nourish our souls and bodies through your goodness and tender mercies. You heal our life's wounds, and your generous love fills us to overflowing. You invite us to stay with you as your friend forever. You have promised that your unfailing love will stay with us always. And for this, we give you our thanks.
Amen. Would the children come forward for the children's story, please?
Scripture readings this morning is Psalm 23, and it's probably one of the best loved psalms in all the Bible. And I think it's so popular because it creates this biblical image of God as the shepherd taking care of his sheep, which would be you and me, all of the people. So the shepherd is taking care of the sheep like God takes care of his people. Well, I wanted to talk to you about the shepherd boy today, but one of the things before a boy can decide to be a shepherd for his dad and go out and take care of the sheep, he has to have the right equipment. And he needs two basic pieces of equipment. He needs a rod and a staff, and both of them are mentioned in Psalm 23. A rod is really just a club. But that's his main means of defense. So he has to make sure that his staff and his rod are the right height. They have to be the right weight so he can carry them. He doesn't want anything too heavy. And they have to fit his hand perfectly. And when he goes out looking for the sapling, he's looking for two saplings, one for his rod, one for his staff. And as soon as he thinks he has the perfect saplings, he cuts them down and he begins to carve and whittle away until he's really satisfied with his equipment. And then he has to begin practicing with that rod. And he takes that rod and he shoots it. And he has to get really good at this. He has to be really fast and very accurate. Because remember, that rod is what's going to protect him and his sheep from predators like wolves and coyotes and other wild dogs and other wild animals. Sometimes he uses that rod, which is really an extension of his arm. It makes it seem like his arm is a lot longer when he's holding on to it, which is a symbol of power and authority and strength. And he uses it to beat the bushes, to scare the snakes away that might bother his sheep. So that's a really important piece of equipment. He has another piece of equipment, which is a staff. Here I have a picture of a staff. I almost forgot to show you. This staff has a hook in it, almost like a cane. Now, the staff that Jesus, the Good Shepherd, is holding up there doesn't have this hook in it because they all personalize their staffs, but they all serve the same purpose. Well, the staff is used in three ways. The first way is to go after some little sheep that's kind of wandered away from the group, and the Good Shepherd, like, let's say, a baby lamb has gotten away from its mother, the Good Shepherd would go out, take his staff, pick up that baby lamb, and bring it back to his mother. And the reason why he uses his staff is because if he picked it up with his hands and his arm and held it against him, then the mother would say, "This isn't my baby. This smells like a human. This isn't my baby." And so he doesn't want that to happen. He wants mom to take care of her baby. So he picks it up with the staff and he brings it back to the mother sheep. The second way that he uses his staff is sometimes sheep get to wandering, they forget what they're doing, or maybe they're on an adventure. But anyway, they might go off and they might get stuck in the rocks and be really afraid to walk down the rocks. And so the shepherd is going to go out with his staff and he's going to hook them underneath the arm, right there in the armpit, and he's going to pull them back to him. And he might actually hook them around the neck, right around the shoulder, because he doesn't want to hurt his sheep. He just wants to bring them closer to him. So the first way that he's using his staff is to bring them back into relationship with the group. The second way is to bring them back into relationship with the shepherd. Because once he gets that sheep off the rocks and back to him, he wants to check it over to make sure that it's okay, that the sheep wasn't harmed in any way before he returns it to the flock. Another way that he uses his staff is to guide the sheep along their path. Maybe it's a path that they have never taken before, so it's a little scary. Maybe it's a treacherous path and has some dangers to it. And the way that the shepherd does that is he takes his staff and he presses gently but firmly against the side of the sheep, not to push him over, but so that he feels that pressure and he knows that he's being guided to go in this direction. So he answers the call and goes in that direction. Well, a good shepherd not only looks after his sheep by using good equipment, he also knows his sheep. And each one of those sheep has a name. And when he calls their name, if they're listening, they come to him. Just like if we are in daily prayer and meditation with God, we learn to listen for God's call to us, and we answer that prayer. Or we answer that call, I should say. The shepherd looks for ways to meet the needs of the lamb, just like God always is looking for ways to meet our needs. And although God isn't looking for a green pasture or a bed for us to lie down in, God is looking for that state of being inside us where we feel peace and calm, and we can reflect upon the demands of the day. So those are some ways that a shepherd takes care of their sheep, and I hope you're able to make connections today in how God is like the good shepherd in taking care of us. So before we pray, the pastor wanted to ask you to do something.
Yes. Yes, today we're going to have a baptism, and the good shepherd is going to bless Rosalina and Brandon. So you know that we have a nice tradition here, and it's that you as children will help me to bless this water. So I'm going to ask you to come forward, come around, come here, yep. Come around this.
I'll get my staff out and guide them.
Yes, yes. You may want to take your, or even one of your gloves. Yeah, good. So, come here, Rosalina. Yes. See, water is such an important element in our lives. We need it for our sustenance. We need it for the earth. We cannot live without it. So I guess that was a wonderful element that God chose for baptism to remind us that we belong to him and to the good shepherd. So just put your hands on the around there, yes, and feel the water. Rosalina, you can put it, yes. Yes, and feel, yeah, you could, no, okay. Don't worry, it's warm, it's not cold. See, all beautiful water. And we ask the Lord to bless this water. Yes, as we laid it on, we'll bless Rosalina and Brandon to receive in their lives the Holy Spirit, but also to be sealed and let the whole world know that they belong to God, as all children belong to God. So this water, the water of our baptism, are blessed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which will wash away all our sins.
That for the adults, but for you, it will protect you. In the name of Jesus, amen. And now Cindy will pray.
Almighty God, our good shepherd, we rest in the confidence that you know each one of us by name, and that you will search us out if we are lost and call us by name, bringing us back to be in relationship with you and one another, as we are not meant to be alone. Protect us from all harm and provide the quiet and peace that we so often need in this hectic and demanding world. Restore our souls and lead us in the paths of righteousness. Amen.
Amen. You may go back to your seats. And at this moment, we come with our prayers of celebration and prayers of intercessions. Again, we celebrate that the Alisea and Rivera families are here, that we are just going to have a wonderful moment baptizing the children. Any baptisms, Zachary and Debbie? Who's Debbie? Hi, birthday, yes, yes. 20 and holding? Yes, yes. I saw John the other day at one of our funerals, and John said, oh, my birthday is coming. And, you know, the man looks fantastic. And I say, how old are you going to be? Well, I'm just gonna be 94. So bless John. So any other celebration? Allison Morris, and she's not here today, but also it's her birthday coming up. So any other celebrations? Yes.
Received very good news on her health. The cancer is gone.
Praise the Lord. Cancer is gone. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And Julie is doing well too. We just need to pray that she stay home completely and rest. You know, she would have been here, but thank God that we have Colleen. Thank you, Colleen, for being here with us and for perhaps maybe the next couple of weeks. But it's good to have you here. Thank you for covering for your friend and for our church. Also, we have Glenna had a successful surgery. Praise God. Praise God for that. Anything else? Any other celebrations?
I know Bill and Joyce are back from Arizona.
Oh, yes. Home. Yes. So praise God for that. Now they came to a little bit colder weather, but it's okay. No, so they will bring their warm from Arizona. Any prayers of concerns that we may have?
I had put out for you to pray for Jason, who was on life support as a result of complications due to Lyme. Jason is with God now.
So at peace. Yes.
For my Aunt Lorraine, who's suffering with cancer.
Okay, for Raymond. Let us bow our heads in prayer, and then we will pray our confessions and listen to the words of assurance. Let us bow our heads in silence for a moment. Precious and beloved God, we give you thanks for the many blessings that we receive from you, for a new year of life, for healing, for direction, for prompt recovery, and for those that you have called into your presence to live in eternity. We give you thanks for children, the children in our midst, for those who are going to be baptized, for the children who are not able to come today, and they are in all kinds of competitions in the community. Bless them and bless their parents. God, we ask blessings for those who are working today, our nurses and doctors, and those who have a second shift in the police or the fire department. Be with them. We also pray, O God, for those who still need the word of hope, healing, direction, salvation. All these we pray and lift up to you, knowing that you answer each one of our prayers. And now we come to you with our confessions. We grumble and complain about our daily lot in life. We read the newspapers, watch the broadcast news, and moan about the evil which flourish in the world. And we wonder, where are you, God? We turn our backs on needs of the poor and give only the cursory acknowledgement of their plight. We throw our hands up in the air and act as though we are defeated. And we cry, why isn't God taking care of all this? Forgive us, patient Lord. Forgive our enemies, our sins, and our sins. Forgive us, and 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 our thoughts and us, have come us, and us, and us, remember that you have called us, to be your witness and your shepherds in this world. Give us strength and courage, joy and peace for all the work that you have called us to do. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd, who laid down his life for us, his sheep, we pray. Amen. In the midst of all that we fear, God is with us. God will not abandon us. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, laid down his life for us and offer forgiveness and hope and peace. As we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, because thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And in that sense, that Christ indeed is a good shepherd, just pass to one another the peace of Christ. Let us join in 611, Child of Blessing, Child of Promise.
Thank you.
invite you to remain standing for the New Testament and the Gospel reading. We're reading first from the book of 1 John. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what he pleases. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. Our gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of John. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down again, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Let us bow our heads in prayer for a moment. You know, one of my favorite authors is C.S. Lewis. Professor Lewis was born and raised as a Protestant, but like many people have done, his faith almost disappeared when he grew older. In his younger college years, he went from being an agnostic to atheist. So he said, I don't believe in God anymore. You know, I am a non-believer. So he just had some struggles with what was his faith. In 1917, he was drafted into the British Army, and a few months after, he went to the battlefield where he was wounded, severely wounded. Then he returned home. You know, he had a lot of struggles after, while he was recuperating. Then he decided to go back to school. For the next 10 years, this agnostic, then atheist, and then, you know, he said, I believe in nothing. This event in his life took, you know, made him to take a turn. So slowly, not overnight, but very slowly, he began to turn around toward his Christian faith. He, you know, the transformation and conversion experience where he rediscovered his faith in Christianity took a long time. But nevertheless, it did happen. As one of his biographers said, Lewis' conviction about his faith in Christ, it was so powerful, slowly, certain, but so powerful that then he was able to be engaged with any person to talk about faith, about the struggles that other people went through. So he was able, I mean, just to talk about those universal questions that we have in life and whether or not God was real. But Lewis' most prominent way to share his thoughts was his writings. He became one of the most famous intellectuals, giants of the 20th century. He taught at Oxford University and wrote more than 30 books, 30 books, and tons of articles and speeches that he gave. He attracted all kinds of audiences. He was well known for his book like Mere Christianity, Out of the Silent Planet, The Screwtape Letters. This is a very interesting book if you ever had a chance. It is the devil, you know, he talks about, he has the devil just to send letters to a nephew on how to live the Christian life. Interesting. This is all science fiction. But made people think. But the one book that I think everybody knows in this room, or perhaps you have watched the movie in the big screen, is The Chronicles of Narnia. Yep, children probably have seen this. The Chronicles of Narnia, The Witch, The Lion, and The Wardrobe. How, are you familiar now? You know, yeah? So that's the Lewis I'm talking about. To this day, Narnia series have sold more than 100 million and has been translated in 47 languages. I think Lewis was brilliant. I mean, was a brilliant writer. To me, The Chronicles of Narnia is a wonderful tool for teachers
and parents to talk about faith with children and youth. It is in Spanish, it's in English, French, German. I mean, you know, so you could get it any way you want to. But the novel, this novel appeals to the creativity, the intellect, and imagination of the young minds. You know, it helps the kids to ask questions, the young seeker, about what is Christianity? I mean, how to make sense of this faith? So the book is, the symbolisms a lot, it's about based in sacrifice, death and life eternal. The witch in the book represents the evil in this world. The beautiful lion, Aslan, represents Christ's characteristics and, you know, how he sacrificed his life to save Edmund and his resurrection. And the wardrobe represents our journey of faith. You know, the Apostle Paul calls our journey a race. Well, Lewis called it the wardrobe. You know, I really love the book. But as you know, this is just science fiction. A novel. The imagination of someone. It is a beautiful allegory. Or as Lewis said himself, a supposal. You know, what if Narnia would exist? Well, in our reading from the Gospel of John, we have also an extraordinary metaphor. But this time, there's some major differences that we see. I think John was a fabulous writer too, and very keen and you know, inviting to question also our faith, but he got some answers. In this chapter that we read, we have Christ identifying himself as the good shepherd. And by the way, Christ has been in the Old Testament identified as the Lion of Judah. He is calling also the believer his lambs, his little sheep. You know, and he is describing whatever takes priority over the believer's relationship with him, he's calling that wolf. The wolf that was gonna come and snatch your soul. In Lewis Chronicles, we have, again, a science fiction novel filled with fascinating imagery and character and tales. But in John's gospel, we have the true account of a historical character, our Savior Jesus Christ, who did give his life for humanity, for each one of us. Oh, yes. And whose spirit is very much alive through the Christian church on this earth. His sacrifice was not at the table stone or the stone table, but at the cross. At the cross. And a cross that many of us wear empty, reminding of his resurrection and that he lives among us. Christ also lives in the church with capital C, a church that is comprised of all those who have accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, as an intimate friend. It was easy for Jesus to use this kind of language, you know, because everyone understood the responsibilities of a shepherd and how sheep did recognize the voice of the caregiver. And Cindy did a fantastic job, yeah, with the description of the shepherd. They also knew that the sheep were an easy catch for wolves because they got entertained or distracted very easily. You know, those little things. Give me food. Yeah, green pastures. I will stay right there. It is wonderful and yummy. Oh, what a green lawn. I do not need to pay attention to anything else. I just get to, you know, use my imagination too about those little lambs. But the more I read about this imagery that Christ used, the more I think, huh, God, you know, you really know the human nature. You really knows how we behave and how we are. For many Christians today, one of their main goals in life is to be fed. Fed by the hour or an hour and a half service, perhaps 40 Sundays a year, participate in church activities here and there, and be involved in the occasional mission project. Praise God that in hope we have many others that has a different view. But that's what we see in the world today. Christians that are just, you know, there on a Sunday morning. Many of these folks do love God. They do love God and recognize the voice of the shepherd, you know? However, these Christians get easily distracted by other priorities in life. The danger here is that without knowing that they have been snatched away from their spiritual community, I mean, they may lose that connection completely. Church becomes a commodity. If I have time, I will go. Or perhaps, you know, what's the point? I am so busy. But John, both in his letter as well as in the gospel, John reminded to the early Christian community that was also being distracted by the persecution and the demands of the cosmopolitan Roman world. He reminded to keep the faith. And that is so relevant for us today. He wrote to them, this is how we know love. Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. The person who keeps Christ's commandments remains in God, and God remains in him or her. How, my brothers and sisters, how do we remain in Christ? How do we keep connected when the demands of so many things out there pull us outside the support and love of the Christian community? How can we know that we are participating, that, you know, that what we are doing is not becoming a secular Christian, a Christian that looks good, you know, with a resume, that volunteers when it's convenient, that worship when there's nothing else in the calendar? How do we know that we are engaged in a relationship with God and with one another? How can we teach our children the morals and values founded in our Christian faith, especially in the commandments, love God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul, and your neighbor as you love yourself? Do we let civic agencies to do that work for us? The Chronicles of Narnia offers a chance to explore those big questions of faith, but the gospel of Jesus Christ allows us and guides us to live our faith in meaningful and transforming ways. In Christ, my friends, the possibilities are endless. So today, as we celebrate this baptism, I invite you to think about the Good Shepherd. How is your relationship with him? Are you letting the wolves, the demands of social life, work, entertainment, relationship, illness, age, even media and technology eat your soul? Are you letting past frustrations, bitterness, selfishness, resentment eat your soul? I say to you, please don't. Too much is at stake. Your life, your soul, your spirit. And I encourage you today to pay attention where you are setting your energies and your priorities. Come to the fold. Be fed with a new set of priorities for your sake and the sake of your loved ones. Amen. Amen. At this moment, I also would like to invite the family to come forward for our baptism. And our lay leaders, yes. More babies to be baptized in the near future. Yes. Come on closer. Yes. Right. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and in the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Who present these children for the sacrament of baptism?
I present these children for baptism.
Okay, Rosalina and Brandon, would you like to be baptized today? Do you know that you are a child of God? Do you love God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit with all your hearts? Very good. Did you hear that? Yeah, yes. To the parents, will you nurture Rosalina and Brandon in Christ's Holy Church that by your teaching, example, and participation in the church, they may be guided to accept God's grace from themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? We will. To the godparents, will you nurture one another in the Christian faith, supporting every possible way Rosalina and Brandon's parent in raising their children in the Christian faith and in the heart of the Christian community? To the congregation, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ, the Good Shepherd? Let us join together professing the Christian faith as proclaimed in the Old and New Testament.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Brandon, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please come to the front? Come on. Oh, you could be. May the Holy Spirit work within you and help you to grow up and become a wonderful man that will do all things for God and for those that you encounter in your way with a lot of wisdom. May the Holy Spirit live within you and may you grow and be a beautiful young woman who also will serve those you encounter in your way, and that they will see God in you. Grow in wisdom and beauty, both of you. May God keep you and protect you from all evil in this world, that you may always be good. Amen. Come with me. So, my dear friends, I present to you our newest disciples of Jesus Christ. Yes, Brandon and Rosalina. Yes. And hopefully in the near future we will have more children. Yes. So they are in your care to continue to pray for them. And to the parents, yes, we have couple of things for you, and they're gonna light a candle, one candle there, and you give that one to Rosalina's parents, Rosalina, and that one too. Yes, would you give me that? And today they will light a candle as a symbol of the Holy Spirit, that they will bring the light of Christ as new disciples of Jesus Christ wherever they go. You may go back to your seats. Blessings. Let us now be prepared for our offerings. Thank you.
Glorious God, we know that your capacity to love is infinitely greater than our own ability. Indeed, you call us to love one another in truth and in action. We yearn to be active disciples so that our hearts truly abide with you. Use these gifts to increase our ability to be your followers. In the name of the Good Shepherd who laid down his life for us, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's join in our final hymn, Savior, Like a Shepherd Lead Us, number 381.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.